Dr. Murphy, thank you very much. You're the director of the Office of Pediatric Therapeutics. What's that?
The Office of Pediatric Therapeutics is supposed to help the Food and Drug Administration work to develop the knowledge that is needed to use medicines and devices properly in children, because we really don't know the dosing and safety and efficacy of a product just because it's been studied in adults.
I guess what underlies here is that children are not just small adults, which leads to the question of why do we have such an office? I don't believe that the FDA has an office of geriatric therapeutics, so why does it have an office of pediatric therapeutics?
Because nobody will study products in children. I'm going to be quite blunt here and say there's a profit in studying older people and even adults. But children are fundamentally healthy. They don't take a lot of medicines. They're a small part of the population. They're very changing. There's many subsets of them. It's difficult to do studies. They can't give informed consent. And, you know, the companies that develop products are businesses. So in a business model, this is not a very good place to go to develop products. So if you look at where we were at the end of the 20th century, about 75% of the products being used in children, and I'm a pediatrician, I practiced for 20 years, I did this for 20 years, we didn't know what the best dose was. We didn't even know for sure that it worked in kids. We were using the best knowledge that we had. But that's the end of the 20th century, that we were not studying things in children. We were making our best guess. And today, at the beginning of the 21st century, we still have a huge amount of work to do. We are still guessing for neonates.
So how does your office work? Do you encourage industry to do these kinds of experiments? Do you do the clinical trials yourself? I mean, how do you find out what really works in children from the point of view of what the FDA does for a living?
We encourage, we facilitate, we actually advocate. We try to get these studies done, and we do it in a number of ways. And this has to do with legislation that Congress enacted at the end of the 20th century in 1998 and forward. And it gave the Food and Drug Administration some powerful tools. And our office was directed in a number of areas to help work with these tools. Particularly, we're mandated to make sure that these trials are ethically constructed and implemented. And we have a pediatric ethicist in our office to make sure that that happens. And to make sure that these products then are safely used in children. And we're mandated specifically to do follow-up on the safety after these products have been studied in kids, because so much is still, so many of these products are still used in children off-label, meaning we don't have the information just because it's out there for adults. So, no, we don't actually do the studies, but what we do is we bring to the Center for Drugs or Biologics or Devices a lot of the coordinated activities along with the various pediatric groups in trying to make sure that the right kind of trials get developed. And another big area that we've been working on has been international cooperation. We've had to work together to make sure that children don't become a commodity in the global market. So we have to make sure that the studies that are being done in Europe and here ask good questions. They're not just being done so that an incentive will be awarded, and that they're done ethically. And I can tell you, we've been doing this for a couple of years now, and it's amazing how much information the other side doesn't know and we know. And so every month we're on the phone with all the different, you know, scientists from the different sites talking about, well, did you know about this study, or did you know about this safety issue? And so there's a huge exchange of information that we have, that our office coordinates to make sure that these studies are implemented on a global level, that they're scientifically, you know, sound, and they're asking good questions, and that they're ethically sound and implemented.
It seems to me that maybe three legs to your stool here. You're an advocate, you're a scientist,
right,
and you're a pediatrician slash mom.
Yes, yes, yes. There are times when I go home and look at what my daughter's giving my grandchildren and say, you know, I think you should not give that until we get more information, or, you know, that's okay to give that, or I think that it is helpful. And this is one of the things when I used to train residents, I used to say part of the training was to go to the local CVS or local drugstore, and I said, now I want you to go in there and I want you to tell me, how are you going to tell that parent what to use over the phone when they call you at night, to learn more about what the products actually are versus how they're marketed. And so I think this is an important part of what we also try to get a better handle on, at least my office, is what does the public really understand about this information that we're putting in the labeling.
As you know, the commissioner, Dr. Hamburg, has put a huge emphasis on improving regulatory science at the agency. And this, what's going on in your office is a good example of that.
And we have a lot that we're involved with. We're working with not just drugs, but also devices, and trying to get, because the incentives just aren't really there for devices. They don't have these patent protections and stuff. And so how do we help companies develop products for children? Because I can tell you a lot of what a doc has to do, because they're not going to not treat the child. They have to improvise, you know, they have to jerry-rig, you know, a device. We're working with small companies trying to get them to know their way through the agency and help them get together with other scientists to help develop products for children, because we are with devices where we were 10, 15 years ago with drugs. There's just a huge amount of work that needs to be done. One of the biggest areas that still remains completely, almost completely unstudied is neonates and prematures. I mean, we're estimating about 90% of the products used on them, and this is a very vulnerable population. Still hasn't been studied, and the reasons they are very complicated is it's not just like you can say, okay, go study this population, because they have different outcomes than adults do. They're vulnerable, but also they can't talk and tell you that it hurts or something's going wrong. Their physiology is different, it's evolving, something may have more of an effect on that than it would on an adult. We don't have what we call the endpoints. To study lung of a drug that might affect asthma, you have the adult do lung function tests. They blow into something. Well, you're not going to get a neonate to do that. You can't get young children to do that. So we have to develop what's called a different endpoint. And that whole area for pain, breathing, all those endpoints for neonates and prematures is yet to be developed. So there's enough work for the next century. And one of my favorite sayings is that ignorance is poor public policy, and it's our job to fix that. And so we're not treating children with our best guess, but with knowledge.